So the name of the subject is Formal Languages and Automata. So as you can see, it is Introduction to Formal Languages and Automata. So there are three basic things which we are going to study in this subject. Number one, what are languages? Number two, what are grammars? And number three, what are machines? And these machines will be called as automatas. So basically, we'll be looking at the following machines. We'll be looking at what is a finite automata, then we'll be looking at what is push down automata, then we'll be looking at Turing machine. So after looking at Turing machine, we'll be looking at the linear bound automata. Okay, and in all these machines, we'll be looking at the deterministic finite automata, non-deterministic finite automata, then deterministic pushdown automata, non-deterministic pushdown automata, then Turing machine, then linear bound automata. So this finite automata will be called as FA. Pushdown automata will be called as PDA, and Turing machine will be called as TM, and linear bound automata will be called as LBA. Fine. And here finite automatas are also of two types. We'll be studying with output and without output. So in with output, again there are different types which are going to explore in this subject. Okay. So initially we'll start with the introduction to languages. Okay. So as you know, this subject, how this subject started, right? So this subject basically started when someone gave a formal definition to languages. Okay. So I'm saying formal definition to languages, and this formal definition to languages means we are going to define languages in the mathematical way. That means we'll be defining languages in mathematical fashion. Okay. And that someone is Chomsky. Sir Noam Chomsky. Noam Chomsky defined what is the formal definition of languages. Right. So here, these languages, we are going to give any string from these languages to these machines, and these machines are going to tell whether these languages are present, whether that string is present in the language or not present in the language. In the same way, these grammars will be used to generate these languages. So I'm sure that you are not getting this. So maybe if you are getting this, then it's okay. And if you are not getting this, then go to the complete video. Then you'll have a complete idea what I'm saying here. Okay. Now let us start. What is a language? Let us give some examples of a language. And after studying the language, let us give what is the example of a finite automata. Fine. Okay. Now let us start. Let us know what is a language. Fine. So before starting a language, we should know what are the symbols present in that language. Let me just take a real world example here. Now if you talk that, if you say that English is a language, then what are the building blocks of this language? Number one, you should know what are the alphabets in the language. Then with the help of these alphabets, you are going to create something called as words in the language. And with the help of words, you will be making something called as strings or sentences in the language, right? And with the help of all these sentences, we'll be defining what is this English language. And there, these things which are going to define whether it is an English language or not, that will be called as a grammar. That will be called as a grammar. That means you should know what are the alphabets present in the English language. You should know what are the words or sentences which are basically called as strings in the language, and then you should know how these strings are combined or coupled with each other to create this English language, and that rule which is going to combine or couple these strings will be called as grammars. Okay. So here when I'm saying this for introduction to formal languages,
That means the languages which we are going to define here, they will be formal. Formal means these languages will be mathematically defined. Okay, now let us see what I am saying is mathematically defined. Okay, let us say in our language we are going to use the alphabets which is denoted by summation. Summation is going to denote what are the alphabets which we are going to use in this language. Now let us say the alphabets which we are going to use in this language are A and B. Okay, now I can say the language is set of all the strings of length exactly 2 or of length exactly numerical 2. Okay, now what are the set of all the strings of length exactly 2 here? The set of all strings of length exactly 2 will be AA, AB, BA and BB. So these are all the strings which are present in this language, and with the help, the set of all these strings will be called as this language L. Okay, so this is just a small example of what we call as a mathematically defined language. Okay, now first of all, initially let us work on this summation. How this summation is going to help us build or create these strings, then after looking at this summation we'll see how we can define different type of languages or various languages over the same alphabet on this summation. Okay, now let us say we have summation. Summation is defining what are the alphabets which are present in the language. So I'm saying what are the alphabets which are present in the language. Okay, now I'm saying let us suppose we have the alphabet which is only single A. Okay, so this is your summation. That means our language is only containing one single alphabet, that is single A. Right, now if you talk about English language, then English is containing 26 alphabets. Here I'm just saying that our language is having only one single alphabet. Now why I'm saying only one single alphabet? Because initially I want to make our language as simple as possible. I want to take as simple examples as possible to define what is a language. Okay, now this is summation. Now if I say I have summation square. Now what is the summation square here? Summation square can be written as summation cross summation, which is equal to A cross A, which is going to give us a string which is AA. Fine. Now if I say what is summation cube? Summation cube is summation cross summation, or summation square cross summation, or summation cross summation square, which is equal to A cross A cross A, or you can say it is equal to AA cross A, which is equal to again AAA. Fine. Now let us say what is summation raised to power 4. Summation raised to power 4 can be written as summation square cross summation, or summation cube cross summation, or summation cross summation cube, and so on. And this can be written as AAA cross A, which is going to give us AAAA, right? And so on. So on. Let us suppose I got summation raised to power n, right? Now, what is this summation? This summation is summation raised to power 1, which is saying set of all strings of length exactly 1. Now I am saying summation square. Summation square means set of all strings where the length is exactly 2, or set of all 2 length strings. Now when I am saying summation cube, that means set of all 3 length strings. When I am saying summation raised to power 4, that means set of all 4 length strings. Fine. Now here in this language we are having only one single alphabet, or sorry, here in this language, right, so you can say that here in this language we are having only one single alphabet, and on this one single alphabet we have defined these summations. Fine. Now if I say I have summation raised to power 0, now summation raised to power 0 can be written as epsilon or lambda. Some books are using epsilon, some books are using lambda. That means strings of length 0, it means strings of length 0. Okay, now do not confuse this strings of length 0 with phi. What I'm saying is, if I say I have phi and I say epsilon, it means we are having strings of length 0. That means this language is having one string whose length is 0, but it means an empty language or empty string, right? These two are different things, they are not equal. Okay, now we'll see what is the difference between these two when we will go on with the subject. So initially just understand what is summation raised to power 0. So summation raised to power 0 is set of all strings of length 0. Summation raised to power 1 is set of all strings of length 1. Summation raised to power 2 is set of all strings of length 2. Now summation raised to power 3 is set of all strings of length 3, and summation raised to power 4 is set of all strings of length 4, and so on, right? Now if we do an infinite union of all these summations, that means if we do summation raised to power 0 union summation raised to power 1 union summation raised to power 2 union summation raised to power 3 up to so on till infinity, this will be called as summation star. This will be called as summation star, and which will be basically a Klein closure, which we are going to see what is this Klein closure. Okay, now let me take one more example in this case and let us see what I am saying. That means if I am saying that summation square, is it correct or not? Okay, let me take one more example here. Fine. Now let us take one more example here. Let us say we have summation as 0, 1. So why I am saying 0, 1? See, we can take any other symbol here. Any alphabet in a language is just a symbol. If you say in English language, what is a capital A? Capital A is just a symbol. What is a capital B? Capital B is just a symbol. Here I can say here dollar, and I can say any other thing that is just a symbol. So we are just taking two symbols here. Either I can take small a, small b, capital A, capital B, or 0, 1, or dollar, or something else. So these are just symbols only, they are nothing else. Now I'm saying summation is equal to 0, 1. That means in our language we have two symbols, and these symbols are 0 and 1. Fine. Now if I say this is summation is power 1, if I say summation square, then summation square will be summation cross summation, which is equal to 0 cross, 1 cross 0, 1, which will be giving us 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1. Fine. Now if I take summation Q, then it is summation square cross summation, or summation cross summation square, or summation cross summation cross summation, which is equal to 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1 cross 0, 1, which is going to give us 0, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 1, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1, 1, 1. So this is summation Q. Now in the same way, let us assume we have summation raised to power N. Then this summation raised to power N can be written as summation raised to power N minus 1 cross summation, or summation cross summation raised to power N minus 1, and so on. It means strings of length N. See, here summation raised to power 0 is assumed epsilon, which is saying strings of length 0. Summation raised to power 1 is strings of length 1. Summation raised to power 2 is strings of length 2. Summation raised to power 3 is strings of length 3. Here you can see every string is of length 3. If I say summation raised to power N, that means strings of length N, and so on. Now if I take an infinite union, that means it will be giving us Klein closure, which is Klein closure,
which is basically all the possible strings. That means it will be summation raised to power 0, which is epsilon, union summation raised to power 1, which is 0, 1, union summation raised to power 2, which is 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1, union summation raised to power 3, which is 0, 0, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1, 1, 1, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1, 1, and so on. Because this summation, this is clean closure, means all the possible strings over this given alphabet. So that means this giving us all the possible strings over the alphabet given by summation is equal to A comma B. So that means it is going to give you all the possible strings. Okay, now does it mean that if I make a combination of every possible string, that means in the language, is it a valid string? What I mean to say is, let us say in English language you have 26 alphabets, which are A, B, C, up to so on, Z. You have total 26 alphabet. Now in case of English language, if I am saying that we have the strings which is cat. Now cat is a valid string because it is present in this language. That means in this language we have defined what is a cat. Cat is, cat is an animal. Now let us say we have bat. Now bat is defined in this language. In English language we have already defined what is a string bat. Now if I say we have zat. Now is zat defined in English? No, it is not defined. Now if I say dat, is dat defined? No. If I say AAT, something like this, at. Now is it defined? No. That means in any given language, it may be possible that some of the strings are valid in the language, or you can say some of the strings which are present in the language, and there may be some strings which are not present in the language. In English language, these two strings are present, but these strings are not present. Fine. Now the same way, we have just defined here what are the possible combinations of the strings. Now when I'm saying we have a language, in that language it does not mean that each and every one of these combinations is a valid combination. In the language we have to define what are the combinations or what are the strings which are present in the language. That definition will be mathematical definition that makes it a formal language. Okay, now let us take some more examples of formal languages here. So here I have just defined what is this summation. Now let me rub this up and let me just take some more examples of formal languages over some given alphabet. Fine.